let's move on. Let's look at some more kinds of misrepresentation that data graphics can provide. This is, again, going back to Edward Tufte. And Edward Tufte has this very nice principle to how do you do honest, accurate data representation in graphs. And he says the representation of numbers as physically measured on the surface of the graphic itself should be directly proportional to the numerical quantities represented. And I want to zoom in and look at kind of a corollary of that I've thought about a lot, which I call the principle of proportional ink. And so this is looking at particularly when we're representing numbers by shading areas on a page, so in bar graphs or that kind of thing. And so I would claim that when a shaded region is used to represent a numerical value, the area of the shaded region should be directly proportional to that corresponding value. So let's look at some examples. Here's an example from Tennessee state government. They're boasting about the increase in jobs that they've been able to produce. An increase in revenue that they've been able to produce in the state. And it looks really impressive. Like, those are just going up really nice. And the problem is, of course, is that this is cut off at 25,000. This goes back to our misleading y-axis. And now, using this principle of proportional ink, we can kind of see what's wrong with cutting off a y-axis. We would like, according to that principle, we'd like the area, the amount of ink, or the area of these figures to be proportional to the values being represented. But, you know, this 2014 value is about 1.08 times the 2010 value, but it's using 2.7 times as much ink. So that, in my book, is misleading. And this sort of provides us with an example of why this, this kind of truncating the axis on a bar graph but not on a line graph can be misleading, right, or is considered misleading. You can, so there they're exaggerating the effect. You can use bar graphs to reduce effects as well. First of all, this is a spectacular duck, right? It's a bookshelf and it's books, pretty cool. But far worse than that, look at this. So here, this is actually zero. And just in case you're able to fix your eyes on that, the designer has added some extra little ornaments just below zero to confuse you. But they look kind of like books, which is cool. And so you might want to actually try to take some information from this, but it's like, oh, there's all these books that nobody reads, and then some people read Harry Potter and Mao's Little Red Book, and everyone reads the Bible, or at least buys it. But that's not what this graph should be telling you at all. There's some pretty horrifying information in this graph. For example, more than twice as many people have read The Da Vinci Code as The Diary of Anne Frank. Designer did not want us to have to live in a world like that, and so you simply can't tell the difference. These use almost exactly the same amount of ink, but it's hidden in the chart, right? So this is another very poorly designed chart, because the idea is that the labels for each thing are set up as these books which sink down below zero and effectively obscure the differences that we would like to be able to see from the graph. Normally, it's okay to truncate the axis on a line graph. But if you fill a line graph, now the area under any given point, the ink under any given point, is sort of needs to answer to the principle of proportional ink. And so this graph is misleading. It's cut off at 28. And it's basically, because we filled it, it's sort of behaving like a bar graph, right? We think, oh, this magnitude is big, that magnitude is small, and so this must be about twice the size of that. I find that misleading. So I think if you're going to fill a line graph, you've got to go all the way down to zero. Here's an interesting one. This is sort of a horrible data design that's becoming more and more popular. I have no idea why. These are these curved bar graphs. So this is a bar graph of arable land per capita. And so we can see, how much land does a country have per person? And, if we look at this graph, we see, say, that the United States here at H, there's the United States at H, and up here at B is Canada. Canada goes going all the way around to there. And it's like, wow, Canada's got a lot more arable land than the U.S., which is true. It's got three times as much arable land as the U.S. But because this is embedded radially like this, and Canada is further outside, it's using up twice as much ink as per bit of arable land. So Canada is actually using six times as much ink, even though it has three times the amount of arable land. When you draw something like this and you order them from smallest to largest, what you're doing is visually exaggerating the differences in your data set, because you trace a longer path around the outside of a circle than around the inside. If you want to shrink the differences in your data set, just reverse it. Put the smallest at the top and the largest on the inside, and you can conceal differences in a data set. I don't know why these are used. And then we move on to, 3D graphics. And there are good reasons to use 3D graphics. This is kind of ugly, but it's an appropriate use of a graph. This is an early graph, too. You know, it's from 1996, before all the fancy graphing software. And this is sort of a reasonable thing to do. They want to tell you a z value as a function of two different variables, right? And so one way to nicely lay that out is as a kind of a 3D bar graph. And well, there's some problems that we'll talk about. This is a reason, that's a decent reason to use a 3D bar graph. It's telling you something you can't do with a 2D bar graph, right? It's doing these three variable relationships. The problem is we see a lot of stuff like this. Here we've just got three different categories and a single variable for each category, but we've chosen to plot it in 3D for whatever reason. The 3D isn't adding anything, right? It's just supposed to look cool. It's just kind of get your attention, make you think, wow, those guys have a great graphic designer, kind of Frankfurt bullshitty. And it comes with some problems. It's not at zero cost. I mean, it's kind of hard to see how long these bars are because they're kind of tilted, they're at an angle. It's hard to see exactly what the magnitudes are going to be here. If you just rotated that in plane, it would be much clearer to see what the actual magnitudes are. Moreover, these end caps use up ink. And this top bar, the end caps use up ink, and they all use up the same amount of ink, irrespective of the length of the bar. And this top bar here, the amount of orange ink, doesn't depend on the length of the orange bar alone. It also depends on the length of the black bar. So we're violating the principle of proportional ink when we do that. Perspective is a disaster. This is a terrible graph. Here you can see the perspective very strongly. Things are kind of shrinking away toward a vanishing point way off over my shoulder. And as a result, it's very, very hard to compare these sizes. I mean, Google here is contracted because it's over toward the vanishing point relative to Excite. Makes it look like people use Bing, for example, and let alone Yahoo. And what is this doing for you, right? It's not adding any clarity to the graph. This could be done as a straight-on bar graph, just as clearly. But this perspective, the angle, the vanishing point, and then you've got these end caps. It's a mess. This travesty is one of the worst. So with foreshortening, right, objects that are in the plane of view are shorter than objects that are perpendicular to the plane of view. So you're starting to see these terrible bent bar graphs. And the problem, one of the really awful things about bent bar graphs is because of foreshortening, things in this plane are shorter than equivalent lengths in this plane. It's almost impossible to accurately interpret the relative sizes of the bars, even if they do go to zero, as I assume they do here. And then there's pie charts. I don't like pie charts to start with because it's very hard to compare the angular sizes of different wedges, whereas it's not so hard to compare them in a bar chart. We can see that things are different heights and which one's bigger. Very hard with wedges on different sides of a circle. There's no reason that I've ever seen why we would draw these things in 3D. So here's one in 3D, and what ends up happening here is because of foreshortening, just this upper face, Android has not quite 50% of the market share, but just this upper face actually corresponds to about 60% of the overall pixels or ink on the top side. And then if we count this lower face as well, it leaps up to 70. So it makes it look like, wow, Android, you know, is really powerful and dominant and exaggerates by violating the principle of proportional ink. Let's come back to taxes to finish up. So we talked about our tax diagram earlier, and we said, wow, all of the money is in the middle class. That's where Obama's going to come, right? Now look at this graph. Here's another graph. This is the tax pyramid. Believe it or not, the richest Americans do pay most of the federal income tax. Now look at this. The money is not in the middle class at all. It's all right here. All the taxation's here in the top 1%. We need to be more grateful. The problem with this graph is that this pyramid, I mean, this should be just a straight bar graph or a stacked bar chart, but this pyramid, you know, has a very broad base and a very narrow top. And so what ends up happening, you know, is the top 1% are paying 39.5% of the taxes, but they get the vast majority of the pixels. In fact, every percentage of tax down here paid by the top 1% gets 120 times as many pixels as the tax, similar percent paid by the bottom 50%. So that's a more than 100-fold misleading that way, just in terms of counting pixels. But you shouldn't just count pixels, because we're viewing this as a 3D object, so we're thinking of area, of volumes. And if you actually compute the volumes of these sections, then each percentage point of tax that's paid by the top 1% has 2,600 times as much implied volume as a percentage point of tax paid by that 50%. So that's a very, very different story than we were seeing before, and very, you know, deeply misleading because of the way it's represented. It's interesting to kind of think back to our binning case and think, well, why does this one say it's in the middle class? This one says it's all in the top 1%. And it really does have a lot to do with bins and the sizes of bins. So we can go and we can look at the distribution of wealth. Who is paying? How many tax returns are in each of these categories? Basically, there are a lot of tax returns up through the, you know, $200,000 category, a few in the up to the $500,000 category, and they get quite scarce out there. Now, if we go back, we think, well, where does the 1% lie? Well, the 1% in 2008 would have lay somewhere around $200,000. So actually, everything to the right of this tallest bar, this is the 1%. All of this is the 1%. And you know, looking at this graph, you see that's a very small, there it is, that's the 1%. It's a very small amount, a number of tax returns. And so, of course, that 1% is paying a lot of the taxes because it's like half of the graph here. So that's how those things sort of resolve.